Hey everybody, it's Jeff. Welcome to the Guided Listening this week. So we're going to work on listen to Milestones, new Milestones. There's several tunes called Milestones. There's an older one written by John Lewis. Miles kind of took some credit for writing that one. And it's more of a bebop tune. This is a modal tune. And really the first modal tune really ever recorded. I think it came a year or so before Kind of Blue. And this tune is an AABA tune. So it's the A sections are 8 measures of G Dorian, another 8 of G Dorian. Then it's 16 of A Aeolian or pure minor, and then a last 8 of G Dorian again. And yeah, so this is you know, obviously a really brand new sound on the scene at the time before Kind of Blue. Interesting. The band is Miles, you know, first classic quintet with Cannonball Adderley on alto sax, John Coltrane on tenor sax, Miles on trumpet, 3 horns, and then Red Garland on piano, Philly Joe Jones on drums, Paul Chambers on bass. So let's do this. Let's listen to it twice. It's not even 6 minutes long. So the first time I kind of want to listen to the composition and to and the rhythm section. And to me, that's, I think, one of the biggest things we can get from these guided listenings is learning to listen into and down into the band. Then we'll listen a second time and listen a little more with what is going on with the soloists. So, you know, let's just jump in. And the biggest thing I want you to be listening for, and, you know, I'll be talking about it, but the difference between the A sections and the bridge. There's literally 2 chords in this tune, and the 2 chords share a lot of the same notes. So it's like, how can there even really be a bridge? There's almost nothing different. It's surprising how little different the bridge is, but then by what these great musicians do, it's actually surprising how big a difference they make. Here's Milestones. You probably heard this before. Almost nothing to the melody. 3 notes. Here's the bridge. Wow, that feels quite different. So it's a different melody, but there's more than just the melody, right? It's a different 3 or 4 notes, but there's something else going on. Back to the last 8. Wow, it's a big shift, right? First of all, let's listen to Philly Joe on the drums. He's doing something interesting. Swinging on the ride cymbal and that cross stick on beat 4. 2-3-4-1, 2-3-4-1. Here's the bridge. He keeps it going. Billy Joe isn't doing anything different on the bridge, is he? Swinging on the cymbal and that beat 4. Side stick or stick on the rim. There it is. Not even a crash cymbal. Fascinating. So Philly Joe is doing one thing independent of everything else. Let's listen to the bass playing. Walking. Quarter notes. Right? Here's the bridge. Ooh, the bass stops walking. That's a big deal. 2 and 4. So he's suspending everything, a pedal tone in the bass. Here's the last A section. He leaves the pedal tone. So walking on the A sections, pedal tone on the bridge. Cool, all right. And we'll pay attention and see if Paul Chambers does that each chorus or whether that was just luck. Let's listen a bit. Listen to the bass. Walking. Here's the bridge. Totally stops walking. And this kind of strumming. Boom, 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 right? So he's done that every bridge so far. Here comes the last A section. 1, 2, 3. Back to walking. So we have a sense. We have a theory of what's going on with the drums. Same thing. We have a theory of what's going on with the bass. Listen to Red Garland comping. See if you can hear back there. Kind of short. short little stabs. Da, 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 da. Here comes the bridge. Ah, long, long, long. So he's playing long half notes at the bridge. Really hinting at the melody. And not anymore. Very interesting. So the rhythm section is really changing things at the bridge. Most fascinating, though, is that the drums is never changing. Not once. Very interesting. John Coltrane solo. Man, it is swinging, though. It is moving ahead. And here's the bridge again. The drums keeps driving, but the bass and the piano are sort of suspending things. So there's sort of two things going on at once, right? And then we go into the last A section. It takes off, right? How cool and swinging that is. Cross stick, walking in the bass, and those nice punchy rhythms in the piano. Man, listen to that all day. And again, this big change. It's not so much a big harmonic change, as it is a textural change, as far as I'm concerned. Last A. And I think this is the end of Coltrane's solo. And listen to this transition. Oh, there's Coltrane. So he played over the end of his solo, didn't come in with the melody, came in about three beats or three measures late. This is the head out. So just three horn solos, no bass, no drums, no piano solo. Miles on this bridge loves toying with the time and delaying things. And it's easy to think they go into a different time feel or time signature or something. They don't. He's just displacing the melody. So here comes the end of the song. 4, 3. All right, this is the end of the song right here. Ah, okay. So they're doing another A section. What happens here? Oh, another A section. It's getting softer. Now, that's not the band getting softer. The band, maybe you could tell, was still playing full blast, so it was called a board fade. The mixing board with all the knobs on it, I got one right there, they bring the fader down. They fade it down. Basically, they turn the volume down. So the band was still playing, and they turned the volume down. It's a board fade, as opposed to real fade. Let's fade out all the instruments together. It has a very, very different sound. So this one is like they're kind of fading into the, you know, they're just getting further away. They're getting further away to the point where we can't hear them anymore, as opposed to they're literally standing in front of me, but just getting softer. It's a very different emotion, different feel, different vibe, different sound. Cool. So the rhythm section, that's really, really interesting. Think about jazz drums, especially bebop and beyond. Jazz drums were about interacting with the soloist, kicking the soloist, giving us rhythmic things, giving us textural things to do. Philly Joe, I don't think, did that once. He came in, dang, 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 clack, dang, 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 clack, dang. That's what he did for 5 minutes and 42 seconds. Just that. I don't know that there was a crash cymbal once. That's a big deal. So I can guarantee Miles said, hey man, play like this. Or the producer said, hey man, play like this. Or Philly said, hey, I'm going to play like this. Like that had to have been so conscious, because Philly Joe never plays like that. Like most drummers don't play like that. That really pared down. That's almost like a rock approach where here's my groove and I'm going to do this till the song's over, period. Interesting. So the bass playing, the piano playing, these guys really probably discussed, I'm guessing they discussed, how do we make this bridge different? So whether Miles said like, man, play long chords at the bridge, play short chords on the A section. It could have been something like that. But there was definitely a decision made. And I would guarantee it was conscious, it was discussed, or it was thought about. So, okay, that's a big deal. There's a lot going on in that simple tune. G minor, A sections, A minor at the bridge. So let's go back and listen one more time. And one interesting thing I want to point out is Cannonball's solo. So when I heard this song, you know, back to when I was a kid first learning jazz, and people would say, yeah, man, it's a minor tune. And I was like, what? Like, I was embarrassed to even say anything because it's like, it didn't sound minor to me. You know, I'm hearing bop, bop, dun, dun, it's popping and it's happy. And then Cannonball comes in. It sounds major to me. Doesn't sound minor. And I was scared to say anything because clearly I was wrong, because there's the sheet and it says minor. And so I assumed something was wrong with me. And that may be the case, but you know, you can leave your comments. Here's what Cannonball's doing. It's a G Dorian sound. What are the notes in G Dorian? G, A, B flat, C, D, E, F, G. So it's the only accidental is, you know, the B flat. It's got a flat third and a flat seven. G, A, B flat, C, D, E, F, G. He's playing C7. What is the C7 or C Mixolydian scale? C, D, E, F, G, A, B flat, C. The same seven notes, different modes of each other. So Cannonball never told me this. I'm not sure that I've seen an analysis of his solo, but I can guarantee that's what he was thinking, because I can see his melodies. I can hear what he's doing, and I can see the notes that he's choosing to highlight. I see him playing C7 arpeggios and licks based on a C7 and C bebop scales. And it's very clear to me that they are playing G minor and he's playing C7 over top. So he's kind of treating it like a sus chord, if you want to think about it that way. Bottom line, now you have a cool way to play over, if you're going to play So What, or if you're going to play Little Sunflower or whatever it is, something with a lot of minor chords in it, play dominant up a fourth. That's what Cannonball is doing. So when you hear his solo, that's going to be a big part of what you hear. When I hear Miles and Coltrane, I'm not really hearing that at all, or I'm hearing much less of it. With Cannonball, it's quite obvious to me. See if you agree. Let's check it out. That simple melody, and every once in a while we hear one of the horn players getting it wrong a little bit. On, off. That on, off beat. Hard to get that right a bunch of times in a row. And there's Miles displacing the melody. Should be on 1 and 3 like that. And there he displaces it again. Alright, so here comes Cannonball solo. Does this sound minor to you? Man, that's happy singing Cannonball, right? Cannonball does this thing where he plays something and repeats it on layers or levels, for lack of a better word. And so coming up here, he does a cool quote, actually. I can't get started. There it is again. I can't get started. Check this out. The way he plays an idea came down that time. He does that idea, motivic playing of sort of going up and down the arpeggio. Fascinating rhythm quote. There's that idea of him sort of going up and down the arpeggio. He does that a lot. Playing an idea, playing it again, using displacement too. What a great handoff, right? Cannonball ends with an idea, Miles grabs it. This is cool as hell, right? Miles, man, listen to the way he's playing. These long notes and long tapered endings. Listen to those note endings. Everything's long, romantic, not bebop, not like what he grew up playing with Charlie Parker. A little little articulation there. Listen to the second chorus now. All right, short notes. Right? Whole first chorus, long note endings, and now tons of shorter ones. You hear that bebop articulation? None of that in the first chorus. So he knows how to build a solo. Was that conscious? I'm not sure. But he knew one way to bring energy is with articulation. And even out of that bridge, how he dialed back at the bridge and now steps on it for the last day. Listen to this. How Coltrane answers that handoff. Man, Coltrane sound, right? Now, I may get hit by lightning for saying this, but there's some little funky things in Coltrane's solo. It's articulation stuff. He's over-articulating. I'll show you what I mean. His tongue and his fingers aren't together. And it happens a bunch. Right? Those ascending figures. He's tonguing a lot. And it ain't working. Beautiful notes. And hints at that sheets of sound. Right, so again, that not quite connecting the articulation. And Coltrane misses, coming in for three measures out of his solo. He was busy soloing, he forgot the melodies coming in. So interesting, right? His articulation was overdone, too hard, and he was tripping over himself quite a bit. Let's listen to the precision of the melody coming out last day section. Let's hear, little cack from Miles there. Let's hear if their horns are together. Oops. 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 Better. Little one there. So there had to have been 10 or 12 mistakes in the melody on this tune. And not a single one of them bothered me. I'm pointing them out to make a point that that imperfection that is lacking in a lot of albums these days, because we have the tools to fix it. It's part of the charm of what was going on here. And the idea that this was literally a snapshot of what happened in that moment on that day. And I think that's something to be prized. I made an album last week for somebody else, and there were little mistakes in the melody, and I was early here and she was late there and whatever else. And so with the computer software in the control room, Pro Tools, we can take a note that I played on the end of three and put it on four. That is the easiest thing in the world to do. Anyone with a laptop and some recording software can do that. Just my part. All the other parts were fine. So Coltrane, we can take Coltrane and do that. If Coltrane played a C sharp and it should have been D, we just drag that note up to D. Done. It's so easy to do. They didn't have that technology, so it kind of had to be left, or they could have done a second take. Maybe they did a second take, but the solos weren't as good. They just decide, let's go with the first take. So that's kind of one of the interesting philosophical things with recording these days, is we can fix all that stuff. Should we? Right? Just because we have the tools to do something, should we do that thing? It's a great philosophical question. And so in the studio last week, for the melody, yes, we changed things to clean up the melody and make it more precise. But in a solo, when I played a wrong note, frankly, I mean, yes, I wish I would have got it right. Yes, I wish I would have played the thing I meant to play. But personally, I don't really want to fix that, or not too often. If the whole solo sucked, yes, can we do another take? But if it was one note, or if I'm Coltrane over-articulating a little bit, it's like, that was me as an imperfect human being on that day, and it had energy, and let's go with that. So that's my philosophy. Other people would want to fix everything. Some people would fix nothing, right? So it's where you fall on that spectrum. So it's cool to listen to these older albums and realize that they weren't perfect. These are gods, these folks playing. These are the geniuses of the music, and they're making mistakes all over the place, okay? So I think that's an important thing to realize, because we hold these people to such a high level and at such high esteem, as we should, but that idea that they're also humans. And the humanity and the little mistakes and foibles in there are what makes this stuff sound great in a way, right? Okay, so hope you enjoyed listening to that. I always want to be calling attention to the rhythm section, the bass, drums, piano, because a lot of us don't really know how to listen to that, or we're not even sure what's going on or what is expected of a bass player. When they do something different, versus what? What is it different from? Okay, so I hope this starts a lot of conversations. I hope you can go back and listen to this and hear some of those, and that stuff gives you some hints. Listen to Cannonball's solo. And yes, Cannonball's playing a different instrument. He's a different person. He's playing in a different way. But how his harmonic and melodic language is different from Miles and Coltrane's, because he's thinking a little different about the harmony. Cool stuff. Thank you for hanging out with me on this. I really enjoy doing these, and love to hear your comments, your thoughts, everything else. Leave them in the comments here, whether it's on YouTube, whether it's inside JazzWire, and I'll see y'all soon.